Hi, I'm Todd Burnson. Thank you for joining us. South Carolina Governor Nikki Haley has proclaimed January as Interfaith Harmony Month in her state in an effort to facilitate communication and understanding between the state's many spiritual traditions.
Whereas open communication, mutual respect, sincere understanding, and unilateral cooperation play a vital role in the promotion of peace and goodwill among all people and between all nations, and whereas affirming our commitment to interfaith harmony, religious liberty, and tolerance for diverse traditions and beliefs contributes to our continued strength and prosperity. Now, therefore, I, Nikki R. Haley, Governor of the great state of South Carolina, do hereby proclaim January 2013 as South Carolina Interfaith Harmony Month throughout the state and encourage all South Carolinians to work together to foster appreciation for the different faiths, beliefs, and cultures found in the Palmetto State.
This proclamation is part of a larger grassroots effort by the Interfaith Partners of South Carolina, which is a nonprofit organization whose mission is to foster understanding and cooperation among the many religious groups. Holli Emore was selected as one of the 10 religious representatives who took part in the proclamation ceremony at the governor's office on Wednesday. She also happens to be a pagan. This is the first time in South Carolina history that any pagan has been invited to participate in such a high-profile interfaith event and represents an important step forward in true spiritual pluralism. Today, we are joined by Holli to discuss the significance of this event. Holli serves on the board of directors for the Interfaith Partners of South Carolina and is the executive director of Cherry Hill Seminary, which is currently the world's only academic pagan ceremony. Hi, Holli. Welcome to the show.
Thank you, Todd.
So tell me about the governor's proclamation.
Well, Governor Nikki Haley proclaimed January to be South Carolina Interfaith Harmony Month. South Carolina is really, really diverse religiously, and this is part of who we are. It's this rich fabric of diversity is part of what makes us strong. And she agreed to do this proclamation. This is one of those rare times when pagans have a very strong, high-profile visibility in a real positive way because we're working really hard.
So what does this mean about the perception of pagans among the leaders of other faith traditions?
It means that the pagan community is beginning to be understood. The imam of one of our mosques here in town was at a meeting at my house one day last year, and he turned to the group in front of me and said, you know, there's something we really need to be cognizant of. I've been using language in ways that I realize now are not positive. He said, for example, the word pagan. I didn't know there was a religion called paganism, and I've used this word in a negative way for years with my congregation, and I need to change that.
Does Cherry Hill do interfaith work as well?
We do. We have a course on interfaith work, and we feel that it's very important that we understand the religions around us. We study world religions at Cherry Hill Seminary from a pagan perspective, but we understand that for many of us, for example, those who have chosen to do chaplaincy, you don't know who you're going to be working with, and you need to have an understanding of other folks that affirms their importance in our wider community.
Well, Holli, thank you very much for joining us on the show, and good luck with your work in South Carolina.
Thank you, Todd.
NASA scientists have discovered what they believe to be a virtual clone of Earth orbiting around a sun very similar to our own. The planet, currently dubbed KOI-172.02, is approximately 1.5 times the size of the Earth and has a 225-day year. And it resides in what scientists refer to as the habitable zone around that sun. The habitable zone is a range of distance from a star where liquid water can exist. If a planet is closer than this habitable zone, any water on the planet boils away. And if the planet is any further, then all of the water on the planet exists only as ice. This is only one of 461 planet candidates announced last week and is to date the closest cousin to Earth that has been found. If it is true that the divine will manifest itself in any environment that can support life, then we may have just found the address to family members we never knew existed. Commercial fishing to satisfy the growing popularity of sushi has pushed the bluefin tuna to the breaking point. A report in the New York Times said that the new scientific study suggests that the bluefin tuna is now on the verge of collapse. The study was conducted by the International Scientific Committee to study the tuna in the Pacific and was based on catch data from 1952 to 2011. This data was used to examine how the population of tuna and tuna-like species has changed over time. Researchers found that the bluefin tuna population has dropped by 96% from its previous levels, which is similar to the drastic decline in other species, like sharks. Most of the fishing for bluefin tuna happens off the coast of Japan, which has virtually no limits on tuna fishing. With the world population currently growing at a rate of almost 250,000 people per day, who all need to be fed, and the unregulated pollution of our oceans, many species of fish may soon disappear without meaningful action. There are several organizations who are working to protect the bluefin tuna, such as the Atlantic Tuna Project, the World Wildlife Foundation, and now even the government of Japan. Assisted reproduction efforts are being studied at Tokyo University of Marine Science. Researcher Goro Yoshisaki and his team believe that they are only a few years away from perfecting the technology to help the bluefin population recover. I hope they are successful. We'll be right back.
Every year, billions of dollars are spent on cancer research. Despite this, it seems that we are no closer to a cure. But what if the answer was right in front of us, hiding in plain sight? There is a common plant that research has proven to have many health properties, yet this information is consistently suppressed. Today I have three guests joining me to discuss the groundbreaking research in the use of medical marijuana and its anti-cancerous properties. With me in the studio is Scott Bowler, Communications Director for the Minnesota Chapter of Normal, a marijuana advocacy group, Len Richmond, producer of the film What If Cannabis Cured Cancer, and Dr. Robert Melamed, research scientist and professor at University of Colorado, Colorado Springs. Thank you for joining me here today.
Well, thank you very much.
My pleasure.
Now, Len, you recently produced a movie called What If Cannabis Cured Cancer? What was your inspiration for the film?
My mother got breast cancer. And this was some years ago. And she's a very stubborn Jewish mother who believes in health foods. And when she was diagnosed with breast cancer, she was determined she was going to cure it naturally with herbs and diet. And we were totally freaked out. All her kids are going, you're going to kill yourself. Well, you got to get chemotherapy and radiation. What the hell are you doing? And she was just very stubborn. She just radically changed her life. She started doing meditation. She started going to these retreats where everybody eats raw food for 2 weeks to cleanse her body. She started investigating all the anti-cancer herbs. Didn't know about cannabis. I mean, it was just like this was not even on her radar. It wasn't on my radar either. She managed to keep the tumor the same size for 4 years. It didn't grow. It didn't spread. She kept going to doctors and having it monitored, and the doctors would keep screaming at her saying, you're killing yourself. There's, you know, you've got to do the regular medical thing. Herbs are not going to cure you. And after 4 years, the tumor started shrinking. Well, that just blew me away. It blew all of us away. The doctor who had been monitoring all this year says, Terry, you've got to tell me what you're doing because I've just been diagnosed with prostate cancer and I want to do the same thing because I don't want to get my prostate taken out. Jeffrey Hergenrather was the first brave doctor who was willing to be interviewed for my film. And he told me about the endocannabinoid system and that we're all born with marijuana in our bodies and this whole health system that marijuana supports that I was just not even aware of, and that really inspired me, and I started tracking down other doctors. Finally, with Jeffrey on board, he helped me get them to be interviewed. It was really, really difficult to get them to go on film. People are scared, which is really, it's shameful. They think it's going to make them look ridiculous to say that cannabis has any healing potential toward cancer because it's been demonized so much that, It's just something that Cheech and Chong do. Obviously, you know, it's for losers, not for people who are looking after their health.
Dr. Melamede, what role do you see this research playing in healthcare?
It's just amazing, but it happens to be true that the endocannabinoid system has a what I call a global homeostatic role in maintaining and promoting our health. Eventually, we'll treat people in a very different fashion than we now do. I mean, we're seeing such amazing results in states that have legal medical marijuana in terms of cancer and headaches and aches and pains caused by, you know, a million different illnesses and conditions.
People do contact me fairly frequently because of the film, saying, I've got cancer, my dad's got cancer, what should we do? Because in the film, I can't be very specific about doses and exactly what the formula is. First of all, because you know, it hadn't really been established. It's beginning to be established now, and I want to pass it on. Smoking a joint is not going to help you. Smoking a joint, if you smoke enough, may help help you prevent getting cancer. They've actually discovered, and it's in my film, the Taskin study at UCLA found that people who were heavy smokers of marijuana got less cancer than people who smoke nothing at all. That's kind of pretty revolutionary. It's basically saying there is a protective effect of cannabis. It doesn't mean you're never going to get cancer, but it has a protective effect. And if you smoke nothing, your chances of getting cancer are higher than if you smoke cannabis. And what I tell people is I describe what happened with my mom and how she shrunk her tumor by completely, you know, reversing the unhealthy lifestyle that she had had. So if you're going to do cannabis, you got to support it with a healthy lifestyle. You know, hopefully become vegan, maybe go on raw foods, check out the other herbs out there, figure out if there's any emotional things involved, and, you know, meditate and clear your mind and stop being stressed out. Stop letting the doctors scare you to death. In my opinion, the doctors frequently make things worse. So, you know, it's the whole holistic effect. It's not just, you know, smoking a joint here or there. You really got to hit it hard, and you have to be consistent, and you have to deal with the fact that you got cancer for a reason. There was something going on, and you have to reverse that.
Scott, tell us a little bit about NORML.
NORML is the National Organization for the Reform of Marijuana Laws, and that's really what NORML is all about. Marijuana was made illegal back in 1937 for the first time through the Marijuana Tax Act of 1937, and I think it was about 70, 72 actually made illegal by Nixon. And the purpose of NORML is to re-legalize the medicine that was legal forever prior to that. It was in every doctor's medical kit. And now it's not, and that's a problem, and NORML is here to fix that.
How did you first hear about Len's movie, What If Cannabis Cured Cancer?
A couple of years ago at an event outside, I can't remember what the event was, but we set up booths at events, like you see when you go to the thing at the park in Minneapolis.
Sure.
Everybody has a booth. We have a booth too, and our executive director, Randy Quast, had set out an array of documentaries about cannabis, the drug war, and so forth, and I was looking through them, and I found What If Cannabis Cured Cancer? Caught my eye, subject I'm very interested in, and so I took the movie home, and I watched it. I was amazed. I was enamored with it. Every time I watch it, I learn something new.
One of the things that they talk about in the film is the endocannabinoid system within our own bodies. Had you ever heard about that before watching this film?
I had heard about it in doing my own research. I'd read a little bit about it. But what's so great about this movie is that it explains in terms that a child can understand what the endocannabinoid system is, where it is, how pervasive it is throughout our entire body, and in certain places like the brain, there are really a lot of them. And this movie explained to me in a way that, like I said, a child can understand what this system is.
So tell me why you think this film is important.
The perception in America today, it's not complete. It's obvious. 18 states realize the truth now, but a lot of America still has a false perception. of marijuana and what it's all about. And the reason for that came around the 1937 tax stamp business. There was a massive propaganda campaign, government and religious propaganda. People vilified cannabis in the name of God, children, sanity, decency, morality, American values, this kind of thing. And they repeated the lies over and over and over again until a whole nation understood marijuana is evil, period.
What I want to know is Normal doing anything to promote the specific film nationally? Because you had mentioned you're doing some things locally, but what's happening on a national level?
Well, National Normal, in 2010, they screened What If Cannabis Cured Cancer at the National Normal Convention. And if you go to Normal's website, norml.org, you can search the title, What If Cannabis Cured Cancer, and you'll find a few articles that talk about the movie and what it's all about. But even more significantly, people could just search, go to Normal and search cancer. I did that yesterday and I found 1,560 articles talking about the effects of cannabis and cannabinoids on cancer, and they're devastating. 1,560 articles, and that's just one website. That's just a place to begin. Everyone should go to Normal, search on that, and start learning the truth.
Much, Scott.
Thank you.
According to the CDC, 7.6 million people die of cancer worldwide every year. Currently in the U.S., there are 18 states with medical marijuana use laws in effect. Normal is just one of many advocacy groups that are working to change perception of marijuana use, and with films like What If Cannabis Cured Cancer, it's clear that evidence is piling up to support the benefits of marijuana as a viable cancer treatment. I'd like to thank everyone again for joining me. This has been a very illuminating conversation. More from the Pagan Voice in just a moment.
Welcome. I am Michelle Plug, and this is As We See It. During this part of the show, we will discuss a few topics that are impacting the world from our perspective. Today, we will focus on the voices demanding justice for the gang rape and murder of a young woman in India, the country coming together for National Slavery and Human Trafficking Prevention Month, the viral parody video that displays the hypocrisy in the celebrities that partook in the Demand a Plan video, and one man's Facebook post that turned into a movement for peace amongst Israel and Iran. The story of a 23-year-old woman being brutally raped and beaten for 2.5 hours before being thrown off a bus in New Delhi has attracted worldwide attention. The physiotherapy student was hospitalized and rendered speechless, but was able to write down the names of 5 men being prosecuted for her rape. Prosecutor Rajiv Mohan said last week that a DNA test confirmed that the blood of the victim matched blood stains found on the clothes of all the accused. She died in the hospital 2 weeks after the incident. So I would like to open up discussion with a quote from the lawyer that's representing 3 out of the 6 men that are accused, where he says, "Until today, I have not seen a single incident or example of rape with a respected lady."
That, to hear that just blows me away, actually. First of all, the incident itself was horrible enough. But the insensitivity that somehow there are some people that are more deserving of that kind of treatment, that just boggles my imagination. And I think that that what this really represents is a problem that I think is a worldwide issue. And that is, for whatever reason, women are not seen as the same as men. I mean, they're not seen as valuable. They're not given the same rights or protection that you see with men.
I don't even know where to begin with that particular comment. You know, as I was researching this, I saw several other kinds of comments like that, like, "Why are you crying? You've only been raped. you know, these kinds of things dehumanize, demoralize, and psychologically traumatize some of these women who are experiencing these things. And, you know, rape is a worldwide problem. You know, you look at some of the statistics, and across the world, you know, rape is an issue. But where is it stemming from? You know, when you look at India, for example, in their culture, it is more prestigious to have a male child than it is to have a female child. You know, and oftentimes they will abort a fetus if it's determined to be female. So I'm wondering, are there packs of men roaming around because there aren't enough women in their country? I feel like this is a multifaceted issue that where do we even begin to understand what's happening in India?
Well, it turns out that, in fact, that actually is happening, especially in northern India. There's such a shortage of women who can be married that there are a lot of men who don't have anybody that they can have as a partner, as a spouse. And so what that has created is that has created this whole market for young girls where, you know, girls are abducted all of the time and sold as wives and are, you know, forced to live with these men or with these families. And it's you know, I mean, this whole thing just speaks to a much larger issue about how do we as men relate to women, and what is it about our culture that would provide space for this kind of thing to happen?
I see in the comments of women being like a man choosing who's going to be their victim. Essentially, it's a power move of this girl deserves to be raped, this girl does not, whether it's in any country. That's still the same attitude, and that's what makes it rape. And with that power play, at what point do we look at it from the perspective of why does that man need to have power in that way over somebody? And where does that need for an aggressive form of power come from?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and that's a great question, right? And I think that that's one of the big questions that we as a society have really been struggling with.
It comes down to what are the values that we teach our children about our mothers, you know, about what it means to be a woman. You know, why are we in a position where it's so much more important to be a man in society, in the world? You know, you look at what's happening in India right now with all of the outrage over this particular situation or event, and there are people screaming that the time has come for change, the time has come for change, and I applaud the people of India to really cry out and say the time has come to make new laws, to look at things differently, to make some changes in society. But is it enough? Because I'm thinking, you know, this looks to me a little bit like what happened in the 70s here in the US. You know, we had the feminist movement where we really took on what does it mean to be a woman, how can we change women's roles within society. But the reality is, 30, 40 years later, you know, in America, women are raped every 45 seconds. You know, in India, it's like every 20 minutes, and that statistic could be based on underreporting. We can't really know how deep it goes. So even though we've had a feminist movement, that has not changed. How we deal with rape has changed, perhaps. The protocols of helping people survive from that experience have changed. And that's what India is facing right now, is how do we build protocols? But how can we get down to the nugget, really, of why this is happening in India, in America, in every country? What's really going on?
I do love that there has been thousands of people protesting, and they've named the girl Damini. They're not allowed to share a victim's name in India through the media. So they've had a lot of signs saying, Damini wants justice, and I'm here to support Damini. I'm here for this cause, and we're giving her a voice. So that actually brings us into our second topic, which is so similar and actually very related to a worldview. January is decidedly National Slavery and Human Trafficking Prevention Month. President Obama cleverly chose January because on January 1st, 1863, the Emancipation Proclamation was put into effect, freeing thousands of slaves. Today, we face the largest recorded number of people enslaved worldwide, and human trafficking is the fastest growing criminal industry. I have a quote here, not just to focus on the sexual trafficking end of this, but a quote from Andrew Hansen, the founder of Men Against the Trafficking of Others. He says, why? Why am I doing this, essentially? Why? Because of the strong demand. And where is that demand coming from? Men. So he's speaking, this is actually a Minnesota-based initiative, and he's really suggesting, like, I'm a man standing up, saying I'm not okay with women being trafficked.
Yeah, I was really surprised to find out, that so much human trafficking actually happens in Minnesota. In Minnesota, it's kind of flyover country, right? It's the Midwest where, you know, everybody thinks
Minnesota
it's
just, Nights, right?
Right, Minnesota Nights. There, you know, you might run into a cow as you're going down the road. We're a little more cosmopolitan than that. But I think, for Minnesota to be such a hub of that, I think it is really interesting. And getting into the whole demand piece, it is interesting, isn't it, that you don't have a lot of young men being abducted and brought to women, but the opposite almost exclusively happens. And I think really what, as a guy, I find all of this kind of stuff just absolutely abhorrent. In fact, it's hard to even imagine what somebody might be thinking for them to justify being able to impose a life of subservience to another human being. But I think one of the things that happens in our culture is that it is so patriarchal in its structure, in the kind of the cultural heritage that we've been handed down. It's, the father knows best. The man is the spiritual leader of the household. And I think that this predominance of man and this mythos of the woman being the means for sin to enter the world, even though people may not say that out loud, I think that a lot of those lessons or a lot of those cultural values are passed down generation to generation, which allows that kind of thing to happen. Mm-hmm. And I think paganism, one of the things that's nice about paganism is that the concept of the balance of power between men and women is a lot different.
Mm-hmm. One thing that I would say in regards to all of human trafficking is that the biggest thing is the component of taking away somebody's choice. Mm-hmm. And as a society that's not involved in it in any way, it's hard to actually imagine not being able to pick out what toothpaste you're going to use in the morning. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's simple choices. What am I going to eat? What am I going to do for work? All of those things that we just choose and naturally have the ability of choice to have are completely stripped of anybody that's a victim to human trafficking.
Mm-hmm. What really shocked me as I was reading up on this subject was, with the exception of 8 states in the U.S., children who are found to be prostitutes are prosecuted as criminals. Mm-hmm. They face criminal charges when... How can a minor choose of their own volition to enter into this? They say within 48 hours of running away from home, a child will be approached by someone in the human trafficking industry. And then this person becomes their everything, their father figure, their provider, their security, their safety. And they, before long, they end up finding that they have no way of leaving. What are they supposed to do? And to get criminal charges on top of that, it doesn't make any sense.
Absolutely, and they have found that 80% of the people in human trafficking, or what we would consider prostitution, were solicited into it between the ages of 12 and 14. So that's something to look at. So more from the Pagan Voice and As We See It after this break. After the Demand a Plan campaign released an online video showcasing many celebrities, Response videos flooded YouTube calling the celebrities hypocritical for preaching their anti-gun beliefs but partaking in gun violence in their roles of entertainment. One video in particular caught my attention by displaying the celebrities speaking for Demand a Plan in their connection with guns throughout their past work. Let's take a quick look.
Columbine.
Virginia Tech.
Tucson.
Aurora.
Fort Hood.
Oak Creek.
Newtown.
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 How many more?
So it's interesting to bring forth this idea of hypocrisy between the celebrities and what they actually do for work.
Right, but you know, one of the things though that got me to thinking was, you know, if we look at, you know, media, movies, etc., as an art form, okay, does art imitate life or does life imitate art, and how do they feed each other? You know, yes, there's a lot of violence in movies and TV shows, etc. today, but does any of that portray people going in and killing innocent children? I mean, there always is sort of a purpose and a plot to these things. I mean, I think yes, there is a certain level of hypocrisy there, but at the same time, it can't be the entire answer.
Well, I think one of the things that I think is really interesting about our society is that even though we talk about how much violence there is in movies and films and things like that and television, yet that's what we spend our money on. In a previous episode, you did a review of the movie The Sessions. Mm-hmm. And when I went into the theater to watch The Sessions, I was about the only person there. You know, there were only a couple of people, and most people that I ask about the Sessions, they're like, what? They never heard of it, mm-hmm. right? But that's a very powerful, very poignant human film. Yet it doesn't put butts in the seats of the theaters.
Right, because there's no sensationalism. There's no right. action. There's no explosions. There's no, you know, super ultra uber masculine guy and the hyper feminine
right.
heroine, you know. And I think it's great for people to want to stand up and say we need to figure out why these school shootings are happening, you know. But the media connection or the idea that these people are trying to portray someone that they've seen in a movie, I think is a little too simplistic.
So I think one of the fascinating things about this is where responsibility lies.
Right.
And I do think that each of us, including celebrities, mm-hmm. has a responsibility to show up in a way in which we influence the world. And how are we influencing the world? Because we write the story. And they write that story, and the writers of these movies write that story. So I do think there's influence by the roles they portray in the movies, not necessarily seeing the violence, not as a viewer viewing violence, but as me growing up seeing what the masculine role should be, mm-hmm. rather than, you know, just seeing a man defined in many different ways.
One of the things that has happened in film over the last 30 years or so is there has been this movement towards creating villains and characters that are just more extreme, more extreme, more extreme, more extreme. I mean, when I watched the Batman movie with the most recent one with the Joker, and I mean, there was just so much just horrible violence in there that is so much different than the way Batman versus the Joker was in the 1970s, right? Where there were these two people that were both very, very intelligent, but there wasn't the kind of just outrageous, extreme, just dehumanizing violence mm-hmm. like you see today.
You know, I just had a realization about our three topics for today, and that is when you're talking about rape and human trafficking and school shootings, it's all male perpetrators. Mm-hmm. You know, and so what does that say about the state of men and masculinity in our current times? You know, maybe the issue isn't so much that women are suffering, because they are, but that men and male culture is suffering, and there's some sort of deep crisis happening that's coming out in these sort of sideways behaviors where we see, you know, people killing innocent children for no good reason. You know, where is that coming from? What's the crisis with masculinity and with men that these things are happening?
Brené Brown actually speaks to that in her book, Daring Greatly, and she speaks to the fact that we don't hold a lot of space for vulnerability in our society. And for women, that comes out as perfectionism. You know, we're supposed to be perfect. For men, it comes out as being violent and being, what's the other word that she used? But basically, it comes out as being this more violent person. And in doing that, if you're not this violent person, if you are, you know, maybe an artist or something else where you don't use violence as your art form, there's no space for our society to have tolerance for that, because then it's not manly. And I feel like the growth opportunity here is for us to accept each other as individuals and be vulnerable and loving with each other.
But one last point I'll make on this, you know, as a guy, you know, I'm troubled by this very phenomenon as well. I mean, if you look at what's going on with men in the United States in particular, I could speak to that because I know a little bit more about that. But we're 10 times more likely to be alcoholic, 10 times more likely to be in jail. Far more aggressive, die earlier. I mean, all of these things really suggest that there's something going on with the way that our culture defines masculinity, mm-hmm. defines what it means to be a man, that is just not working very well. And I think that films such as a lot of the action films, where there's this really disconnection with other people and this. You know, extremism, whether that be in superpowers or whether that be in violence or, you know, what that is, there's like this pressure for men to be, you know, not vulnerable and also to really be lose touch with our own feelings, with what makes us human. One of the things that makes me just absolutely scream is when I see fathers telling their little kids when they fall and they start crying is when I hear them say "man up" and stuff like that. It's like, no, you know, I mean, what you're telling your kid is that their attachment to where they are emotionally is not okay, and if you lose that attachment, it's not that those emotions don't come out; they just come out in ways that are unpredictable, mm-hmm. And less helpful.
And now coming to our fourth topic, one man's attempt to connect the civilians of Israel and Iran has turned into a viral peace movement. Israeli citizen Ronnie Edry began this venture with a self-designed image that he posted on Facebook. The message: Iranians, we will never bomb your country. We heart you. The objective to open up a conversation amongst people living in these countries is portrayed in his personal letter attached to the poster. So his letter read, "To the Iranian people, to all the fathers, mothers, children, brothers, and sisters, for there to be a war between us, first we must be afraid of each other. We must hate. I'm not afraid of you. I don't hate you. I don't even know you. No Iranian ever did me no harm. I never even met an Iranian. Just one in Paris in a museum. Nice dude. I see sometime here on the TV an Iranian. He is talking about war. I'm sure he does not represent all of the people of Iran. If you see someone on your TV talking about bombing you, be sure he does not represent all of us. I'm not an official representative of my country. I'm a father and a teacher. I know the streets of my town. I talk with my neighbors, my family, my students, my friends, and in the name of all of these people, we love you. We mean you no harm. On the contrary, we want to meet, have some coffee, and talk about sports. To all those who feel the same, share this message and help it reach the Iranian people." When Edry opened up dialogue with Iran, more Israelis wanted to create posters. Then Iranians responded with the same message, Iranians heart Israel. After just 1 week, 7,000 people liked Ronnie's Facebook post, and so the Israel Loves Iran Facebook page was created. Now over 101,000 people have liked this page, and the conversation among civilians and other nations on the verge of war have opened up as a result. People in the countries of France, Palestine, India, Syria, Germany, America, and many more have opened up conversations via Facebook. This movement has given a voice to the people of the world to share the similar desire for peace.
I gotta tell you, when I watched this on TED Talks, I just cried. I mean, and even just like listening to you now, I'm trying not to cry because I just, this is what we need. We need dialogue amongst the common people around the world to realize that what's happening in the political sphere is not necessarily what is reflected by the citizens of the world. And I love what this person did and the movement that it inspired, and I hope that it keeps going.
I think that this phenomenon really shows that the average person wants peace. They want dialogue. They want connection. And it's unfortunate that there are people in positions of power who have ideologies that are unwilling to let that occur.
Absolutely. This story struck my heart, and one of the other movements that was created off of it was posters that now say, this is not my war, and that not my war is very highlighted, and I find that to be so beautiful because so much of it, we don't want to fight. We don't want the wars. So that being said, time is up for today's discussion. Thank you for watching. I am Michelle Plug. Stay tuned for more from the Pagan Voice.
In 1972, Jean Manford founded the national support organization, Parents, Families, and Friends of Lesbians and Gays, also known as PFLAG, after one of her sons was beaten at a gay rights demonstration in New York City. At the time, homosexuality was still classified as a mental illness, sodomy laws were still on the books in many states, and there were no legal protections against discrimination based on sexual orientation. Shortly after her son's beating, Ms. Manford marched with her son in New York's Christopher Street Liberation Day March, carrying a sign saying, "Parents of gays, unite in support of our children." Other participants in the parade flocked to Ms. Manford, embracing her and begging her to talk to their parents, and soon after, PFLAG was born. Although only about 20 people attended the first meeting of PFLAG when it was established in 1973, today, it reports over 200,000 members and more than 300 affiliates across the U.S. In 2009, President Obama praised her at a human rights campaign banquet for, quote, "a love more powerful than any insult or injury." She attended college in Alabama before completing her degree at Queens College in New York. She lived most of her life in Queens and left New York in 1996 for Minnesota, before finally moving in with her daughter in Daly City. Jean Manford died on Tuesday, January 8th, at the age of 92. Let us pause for a moment to honor her tireless work to fight violence and discrimination. Well, that's it for today's show. This program would not have been possible without the generous support and hard work of many people, including our studio director, Jesse LaPointe, camera operator Rob Clares, audio tech, makeup artist, and editor Carissa Roy, studio interns Corey Strand and Christy Rumpsa, communications director Ashley Mondor, and our sponsors Magus Books, The Edge Magazine, Summerlin Spirit Festival, and the generous financial support from viewers like you. We could not do it without you. I look forward to seeing you again on the next episode of The Pagan Voice. Have an amazing week.